So I, you know, something I always hear when people do talk about climate change, say in the mainstream press, is that there's always this sense like it's getting bad, but we still have time to deal with it. We still have time to, I mean, there's ideas like geoengineering is thrown around, like we can alter the atmosphere, or we can, I don't know. There's all these schemes that have been kind of thrown out there, just sort of to give the idea that, you know, there are people that are in charge and they're going to figure out how to get us out of this bind that we've gotten ourselves into. And what I think more and more is happening is that that story isn't holding up anymore. And I think a lot of people sense that, oh, we've reached the point where certain thresholds have been crossed and it's not going to be okay. You know, even if we did stop, say, producing all this carbon and deforesting and destroying the oceans, doing all the things that we're doing to systematically destroy the biosphere and the complexity of this of the systems on this planet. If that were to somehow magically stop, you know, there's already too much that has already happened. You know, there. So let me ask you this question: If let's just say in this reality, this magical reality where human beings have a shift in consciousness and they're like, oh, we're gonna stop doing this, we're gonna stop destroying the planet. Even then, what would human beings expect in the future? What would we have to adapt to in order for us to survive?
We're going to have to adapt to sea levels that are anywhere from 10 to 30 to 50 feet higher than they are today, depending on, you know, Western Antarctic ice shelf's going to go, the better part of Greenland's going to go, parts of Eastern Antarctica are already showing signs of coming unplugged. So we're looking at tens of feet of sea level rise that are essentially already baked into the system. We're looking at, I think, atmospheric temperature increases that are already baked into the system of anywhere from a minimum of probably 3 C up to 6, 7, 8 degrees C. Humans have never lived on a planet at 3.5 C above pre-industrial baseline levels. The last time there was the last time this planet was at 3.5 C above pre-industrial baseline levels, oceans were 60 feet higher, and there were snakes the size of yellow school buses on the planet. It gives you an idea. Like we are already very much in it, and then that goes into question: how much potable water, how much fresh water will be available for humans? And then, you know, what is that going to mean for arable land and agriculture? Will the planet have the capacity to feed 7.5 billion people? Absolutely not. There's, you know, there's numerous scientists that I've spoken with that think that it's just inevitable that we're going to see a pretty dramatic drop in human populations because there simply won't be enough arable land because of climate disruption to feed the numbers anywhere near the numbers that we have today. So that is certainly where we're heading. And I think, you know, I want to address that, you know, the point that you bring up that the mainstream discourse is still that, you know, we can mitigate this, we can do better, we can change this, and there's still time. And I think that there's a couple of different things going on there. One, and certainly across a lot of the environmental leaders of the left, is that people don't want to they don't want to give people the hard facts about how far along we already are because they're afraid people will just stop trying to do the right thing and they'll give up and just say, oh, to hell with it. It's not worth trying to lower my own CO2 emissions, et cetera, et cetera. So that's one of the pieces of the thinking. And then, of course, global leaders that, like, for example, the Trump administration, I mean, they could just give a damn about mitigation or anything. They're all about we need to maximize profit and take as much out of the system as we can get before it's all gone. So that's what that's about. And then another part of it is, I think, the denialism from the perspective of the Elizabeth Kubler-Ross five stages of grief model, that the denialism that a lot of people just want to stay in there in some capacity because really looking at what's actually happening is really hard, and it's going to bring up a lot of strong emotions, and we're going to have grief about it, and we're going to all have to grapple with that personally, and then start asking ourselves some really hard questions, like, such as, okay, we live in a completely different paradigm now. The world, yeah, I'm 49, and the world I grew up in, you know, there was this idea that, okay, you go to school, if you want to go to college, you could try to go to college and then get a career and work your life, and where do you want to live? And, you know, there's all this stability inherent in that worldview. And that is over. There is no more stability. There is nothing that we can count on for sure in the future, that things are going to be stable enough that we'd be able to run out those kinds of scenarios. And I think that, again, it's just really important for us not to run around and be gloom and doom and, hey, I need to beat you over the head with all this hard scientific information that I have. But I think we need to start having conversations about how are each of us dealing with it and what can we do to support each other in dealing with it, because it absolutely means we still need to be trying to do what we can to mitigate the situation and lower our own personal CO2 emissions and try to raise consciousness about what's happening. But I think we have to start with first, how are we going to keep talking about this and support each other while we do, and while more and more people wake up? Because I think that we are in a moment of the silver lining of the Trump administration is they have made it abundantly clear that not only are we off the cliff, but we're going to punch on the gas and get to the bottom as quickly as we can. And the upswing of that is, I think it's waking up more and more people than were before they came into power.